about upcoming deadlines, right? Paper is due on Friday by 11:59 p.m. in the Dropbox on Georgia View. I will look at drafts that you want to show me up until Wednesday, right? So if you have something you want to get me by Wednesday, I will look at it. If you have something that you get me after Wednesday, I will look at it if I have time to. But I cannot guarantee I will have time because I have a whole bunch of Comp 2 drafts coming in as well, and a World Lit paper that is also due on Friday. So the earlier you can get me a draft, the more likely it is I will be able to give you good feedback. Does anybody have any questions about the paper?
How long is it again?
2,000 to 2,500 words. So roughly 4 or 5 pages, double spaced. Anything else? Okay, what about the exam? Does anyone have any questions about the exam a week from today?
Regarding the paper, can we do what we presented on, or?
No, I would prefer you not do what you presented on because I don't want this to be a research paper. And you have already done research on. But yeah, you can do the final paper on what you presented on if you want to, but you don't have to. Just not the midterm paper. Any questions at all about the exam? Everybody knows that the exam sample questions are up, right? And they are in Georgia View in the syllabus and assignments folder, and you can access them there. Okay, great. So before we get started then, let me just gauge so I know what we're doing here. How many of you read either The Daughters of the Late Colonel or The Garden Party? Okay, good. How many of you read both of those? Okay, but you, okay, and okay, right. Enough of you then that it, okay. Enough of you then to get through this. All right. So what did you think of these? Where do you want to start?
I thought the one that I read was kind of cool. Can't say much for the other.
I didn't like the stories until the end of each story.
Okay.
They were kind of boring, normal, and then you kind of got it at the end.
Okay, what was it about the ends of these stories that grabbed you?
The characters usually come to realize something about themselves in relation to their environment or what's been going on.
Mm-hmm. And are they able to express it?
Not really.
Not in the one I read.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They can't put into words the experience that they've had, right? You know, the daughters of the late Colonel, Josephine and Constantia, can't remember what it is they wanted to say to each other at the very end, right? They both had these internal revelations that they then are unable to put into words. And Laura, at the end of the garden party, can't explain to her brother just exactly what she experienced when she saw the young Carter's corpse, right? So we have in both stories this kind of inability to assimilate experience to language. Right, this kind of disjunction. Between experience and language. Now, have we seen something like this before?
In Heart of Darkness, didn't we kind of talk about that briefly, about how, well, maybe I'm thinking something else, where he would notice things mm-hmm. and then only be able to describe them in retrospect?
Yeah, Marlo, the narrator in Heart of Darkness, was doing this delayed decoding, right? Where he'd see something happen, like he saw his helmsman fall down, you know, clutching himself, and then doesn't notice until, oh, he's got a spear in his chest. right? He sees these spheres on fence posts around Kurtz's hut and doesn't realize until later on, oh, those are human heads, right? So it doesn't work quite the same way as what Mansfield is doing, but this kind of disconnect between language and the thing it describes is a very, very common modernist literary technique, right? Experiences that you can't quite put into words, or that the characters can't quite put into words, right? Usually the author can put it into words. I mean, we have Mansfield herself describing the sort of process each character is going through, but the characters themselves can't articulate it. And I think that some of that has to do, perhaps, with the kinds of characters we're dealing with here. Our prospective character in the garden party is who? Yeah, and who or what is Laura? Yeah, she's a privileged teenage girl, right? Yeah. And she tends to experience the world in certain pre-programmed ways that we'll go into in a minute, that aren't quite like the way her family experiences things. She is at least slightly different from most of her more unappealing relatives. She tends to respond to experiences in a sort of predictable pattern. Yeah, Dan?
Does this have anything to do with Little Women? Because the names are somewhat similar.
You know, Not that I'm aware of. I don't know whether Mansfield ever read Little Women. I mean, honestly, I've never read Little Women all the way through. Can you tell me where you're going with this, or what's?
Well, I mean, the names were kind of similar. I mean,
you had
Josephine or Joe, and
yeah. Okay, it would be, there's a Meg, there's a Jose, which would be short for Josephine or Josepha.
And then you have Meg, who was also in Little Women, and Laura and Joe from Little Women they kind of don't fit in with their families.
Okay.
And they kind of notice that they don't fit in with the families.
Yeah.
It just seemed like it was like... Yeah, and
I think maybe it's a similar situation being described. I would suggest that most of the similarities are probably accidental. The big influences on Mansfield's writing would be later on, by the time she is writing these short stories. Virginia Woolf and Woolf's Bloomsbury Circle. We'll talk about these people in more detail when we talk about Mrs. Dalloway.
The characters are generally asleep, and Laura tends to be awakening to the point where she can enjoy the experiences of life.
Yeah, and that gets at one of the other big influences on Mansfield's writing. Walter Pater. Remember when that Pater essay that I showed you at the beginning of the course, right? And he talks about, time as being kind of discontinuous, and that really what life is these moments of intense aesthetic involvement, right? Intense aesthetic enjoyment. And we see Laura having these kinds of little experiences all through the story, right? When the workman picks up the little bit of lavender to sniff it, she gets kind of lost in that little crystallized moment. Enjoying the bread and butter outside, right? She gets lost in that little crystallized moment. Even, when she's viewing the young Carter's corpse, it's another one of these, hard gem-like shells of experience, right? She's burning always with this hard gem-like flame. The big one, though, I think, in terms of what Kermit is talking about, I think that the interesting one to note is the experience with the canna lilies. Because this does point to a kind of awakening that's going on in the story. Does anybody know what a canna lily is or what they look like?
Big red flowers, aren't they red?
Yeah, they're like a bright pink, right? Usually like a bright pink. And they're not true lilies. If we look at the if somebody finds the passage of the canna lilies before I do, please. Okay, page 289. The front door peeled, and there sounded the rustle of Sadie's print skirt on the stairs. A man's voice murmured, Sadie answered, careless, I'm sure I don't know. Wait, I'll ask Mrs. Sheridan. What is it, Sadie? Laura came into the hall. It's the florist, Miss Laura. It was indeed. There, just inside the door, stood a wide, shallow tray full of pots and pink lilies. No other kind. Nothing but lilies. Canna lilies, big pink flowers, wide open, radiant, almost frighteningly alive on bright crimson stems. Oh, Sadie, said Laura, and the sound was like a little moan. She crouched down as if to warm herself at that blaze of lilies. She felt they were in her fingers, on her lips, growing in her breast. Now, what kind of awakening does this sound like?
Sounds like the beginning of, was that Zora Neale Hurston book? She has that experience with the peach tree or something. What is it called? You know what I'm talking about, the Zora Neale Hurston book?
There are watching God.
Yeah, it sounds like that. Mm-hmm. Like exactly like that.
Okay, and what is... I'm actually not all that familiar with the Thurston book, so what is... I'm not an Americanist. You guys keep throwing out all this American.
I didn't know about an education. Sorry.
So what's going on with the peach tree blossoming and the Zora Neale Hurston book?
They're using like pollination and flowers as like a very thinly veiled analogy for sexual awakening and all that.
Mm-hmm. This is a little bit less thinly veiled. Because a canna lily in full bloom kind of looks like a vagina. And Laura gives a little moan as she is feeling the experience. And she becomes much more physically demonstrative with members of her family after this, right? She squeezes her mother and bites her on the ear, which is a weirdly kind of sexual thing for a child to do to a parent. Just before this, as she's been admiring the workmen, right, she, you know, gives her brother rather a more affectionate hug than one often sees in sibling relationships. I think it's also interesting that the brother and sister have such similar names, right? Laura and Laurie. Yeah,
I wouldn't consider twins or not. Because it's not really stated if they're older or not.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
the names are very similar, and they seem to function as a pair, right? Yeah, he's the one who comes and fetches her, and the narrator at least claims that he understands what she means. She expects him to be more sympathetic than the others. So yeah, I think there is a suggestion that they are twins, or at least the characters are twinned. Yeah, what are you going to say, Daniel?
Does he complete her thought in the end? Like, they're two sides of the same person. Like, he says, isn't it, darling? It kind of feels like he understands what she's trying to say. Like,
yeah.
They're almost a reflection of one another, just male and female.
Mm-hmm. I think there is... there is a key difference between them, though, that I think we have to try to keep in mind here, right? Where is Laurie while Laura and her other sisters are setting up for the party? Why isn't he there to help?
He went with the dad to the town, the office.
Yeah, he's working in the family business, right?
I
So he's already inducted, already initiated into the concerns of this upper middle class settler family in New Zealand. Laura isn't quite there yet, right? So I think rather than completing Laura's thoughts, what Laurie is doing is completing Laura's initiation into the family circle, right? The adult family circle. There's one critic who actually describes this story as sort of Laura's movement from experience to innocence. That the family itself lives a kind of cloistered, innocent existence that is not touched by the concerns of the neighborhood around them. I mean, when Mrs. Sheridan, for example, hears that a man has died, what's her response? Not in the garden, right? Oh, as long as it didn't happen in our garden, then fine, whatever, right? The party has to go on. These people are going to have their party regardless of what happens in the lower lane. Do any of Laura's siblings show the same level of sympathy for the Carter and his family that Laura does?
Not really. She never asked him, so we don't know his entire view on it, but others.
Right.
They just pass it like mother.
Yeah. So why should we not have our party? And the sibling that we see the most of, at least in the early part of the story, right, is the sister Jose. And what are we told about Jose? How is Jose described? Are there particular words that seem to come up paired with her name quite a lot?
When she's singing, she's described as mournful.
What's that?
When she's singing.
Uh-huh.
She's described as mournful. Even her song itself is pretty depressing.
She looked mournfully and enigmatically, page 290, at her mother and Laura as they came in. Right? This life is weary, a tear, a sigh. A love that changes, this life is weary, a tear, a sigh. A love that changes, and then goodbye. But at the word goodbye, and although the piano sounded more desperate than ever, her face broke into a brilliant, dreadfully unsympathetic smile. Aren't I in good voice, Mummy? She beamed. So she clearly doesn't feel the sentiment of the sad song that she's singing, right? And why is it the servants love obeying her? Jose loved giving orders to the servants, and they loved obeying her. She always made them feel they were taking part in some drama, right? So everything she does is a kind of performance. Right, she's also frequently referred to, particularly when she's saying something extremely unsympathetic, as practical. Right. If we look on page 293, for example, when they've heard about the death of the workman. And just think of what the band would sound like to that poor woman, said Laura. Oh, Laura. Jose began to be seriously annoyed. If you're going to stop a band playing every time someone has an accident, you'll lead a very strenuous life. I'm every bit as sorry about it as you. I feel just as sympathetic. Her eyes hardened. She looked at her sister just as she used to when they were little and fighting together. You won't bring a drunken workman back to life by being sentimental, she said softly. Drunk? Who said he was drunk? Laura turned ferociously on Jose. She said, just as they had used to say on those occasions, I'm going straight up to tell mother. So, on the one hand, this is a demonstration that these girls really are still children, right? That I'm going to tell mother is still a viable option, a viable solution. But it also shows a difference in sentiment between these two, right? Jose doesn't give a shit what happens off their property. Laura does. Laura is worried about how their merriment will sound to the people down below in the lane who are mourning this dead Carter. And who aligns more closely with the values of the family?
Jose.
Clearly Jose, right? Because when Laura goes up to Mother, Mother tells her exactly the same thing, right? Right, we mustn't stop our fun, we mustn't stop our party for this person's sake. And what does the mother do to get Laura to stop caring so much about this?
She distracts her with a hat.
Yeah, she gives her a hat.
She's like, I'll give you this, just forget everything else.
Yeah, what's going on with the hat?
It's almost a symbolic gesture of the aristocrat. Like, it has the yellow daisies in it, and it's
yeah.
all black, with a velvet ribbon on it.
Yep.
It's very rich in color and meaning.
Yep, gold daisies, and a black velvet streamer. Which actually makes it weirdly appropriate for a funeral when she does go at the end to the workman's house. But how does the hat keep coming up? Right? It's not that Mrs. Sheridan gives her the hat and then this all blows over, right? The hat keeps coming back. Right? Page 294, when she gets the hat, Mother, isn't it really terribly heartless of us? Darling, Mrs. Sheridan got up and came over to her, carrying the hat. Before Laura could stop her, she had popped it on. My child, said her mother, the hat is yours. It's made for you. It's much too young for me. I have never seen you look such a picture. Look at yourself. And she held up her hand mirror. So,
the hat may be the association with her family because she's so different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is, I pass my hat on to you, right? I put my hat on you, and you become like us. So, yeah, this is part of Laura's initiation. Right. But mother, Laura began again. She couldn't look at herself. She turned aside. This time, Mrs. Sheridan lost patience, just as Jose had done. You're being very absurd, Laura, she said coldly. People like that don't expect sacrifices from us. And it's not very sympathetic to spoil everybody's enjoyment just as you're doing now. Now, by everybody, she only includes people of her own class who are invited to the party, right? Everybody's enjoyment will not be spoiled if the party is canceled out of consideration for the funeral going on nearby. But Mrs. Sheridan doesn't think of those people as included in her world, right? Which sort of gets at the image, like the fact that this is a garden party. What kinds of ideas do we associate with gardens?
New life.
Okay, yeah, new life.
Also death.
Life and death.
Usually from body freedom.
Yeah, okay, yeah, a kind of state of innocence, right? Right, one other thing that's important to note about gardens, we're talking about cultivated plant life here, right? We're not talking about flowers, trees, fruits, whatever, growing wild. We're talking about a kind of artificial state of innocence that is shaped by human hands, or it's constructed. The garden is artificial.
Not only that, but it's something that they can control.
Yeah.
Because they can't control the life and the death of the person, just like they can't control our emotion towards that. The
yeah.
Garden.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, this is the garden is a world that's completely under their control. Everything that happens there is up to them. And so they can make it a place of joy and merriment and innocence, right? But, right, this shouldn't make us forget that it is still artificial. It's not really, it's fake nature. All right, so, I don't understand, said Laura. And she walked quickly out of the room into her own bedroom. There, quite by chance, the first thing she saw was this charming girl in the mirror, in her black hat trimmed with gold daisies and a long black velvet ribbon. Never had she imagined she could look like that. Is mother right, she thought? And now perhaps, now she hoped her mother was right. Am I being extravagant? Perhaps it was extravagant. Just for a moment, she had another glimpse of the poor woman and those little children and the body being carried into the house. But it all seemed blurred, unreal, like a picture in the newspaper. I'll remember it again after the party's over, she decided. And somehow that seemed quite the best plan. So as she admires herself in the hat, what happens to the scenario that she's imagining in the dead workman's house?
She decides she will walk down both sides of the street.
Well, it's getting fuzzier in her head, right? She starts to turn it into an abstraction, right? I mean, yeah, she will try to walk down, but she's been trying to walk down both sides of the street the whole story here, right? She's been trying to make nice with the workmen and, you know, thinking about, oh, how nice it would be to have workmen for friends instead of those silly boys who come for dinner on Sundays. Right, not realizing how far away from her own world their world is. But yeah, as she puts on the hat, she's putting on mother's values, right? We see that, like, okay, we have to have the party now. We have to go through with the party. And everyone admires her hat, right? Page 295. Right, Laurie says, my word, Laura, you do look stunning. What an absolutely topping hat. Laura said faintly, is it? And smiled up at Laurie and didn't tell him after all, right? She doesn't tell him about the dead workman because he just complimented her hat. The hat is more important. Soon after that, people began coming in streams. The band struck up, the hired waiters ran from the house to the marquee. Whereas you looked that wherever you looked, there were couples strolling, bending to the flowers, greeting, moving on over the lawn. They were like bright birds that had alighted in the Sheridan's garden for this one afternoon on their way to where? Ah, what happiness it is to be with people who are all happy, to press hands, press cheeks, smile into eyes. Darling Laura, how well you look. What a becoming hat, child. Laura, you look quite Spanish. I've never seen you look so striking. Right, so she is completely bowled over by everybody talking about how great she looks in this hat, right? This hat makes her feel like a beautiful adult woman. Now, what happens with the hat once she does take the leftovers from the party down into the lane? Is the hat still something for her to be proud of?
It's part of the reason why they start to view her as other. She becomes a spectacle mystery.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's like, now, do we have evidence that people are actually making a spectacle of her?
No,
but yeah, but she feels like this is making her stand out, right? Page 296. Now the broad road was crossed. The lane began, smoky and dark. Women in shawls and men's tweed caps hurried by. Men hung over the palings, the children played in the doorways. A low hum came from the mean little cottages. In some of them, there was a flicker of light and a shadow, crab-like, moved across the window. Laura bent her head and hurried on. She wished now she had put on a coat. How her frock shone, and the big hat with the velvet streamer. If only it was another hat. Were the people looking at her? They must be. It was a mistake to have come. She knew it all along. It was a mistake. Should she go back even now? Right, so the hat is a class marker. That shows the people in the lane just who she is, right? And what group of people she belongs to, right? It's not a tweed cap or a shawl like the people who live in the lane wear. And it makes her frightfully conscious again of class difference, right? Exactly the kind of class difference that she was trying to erase when she was giving instructions to the workmen, when instead they just told her where the best place to put the marquee was, right? So it's a reminder again of these class distinctions. And indeed, what does she say to the widow and the sister-in-law as she's leaving the house?
Please forgive me for the hat.
Yeah, forgive my hat, right? Essentially, forgive me for being rich and for condescending to you, and for bringing you the scraps we didn't eat from the party. Forgive my hat. Now, there's another thing that connects the scene in which she looks at the workman's body with the scene in which her mother gives her the hat. What does the sister-in-law tell her as she pulls her over to the corpse about the body? If we look on the page of two, on the top of page 298, anything ring a bell there? Yeah, he looks a picture, right? Much as Laura's mother had told her, she looked a picture in the hat, right? So there's this connection here between the dead Carter and Laura, right? They both look a picture. Which I would suggest means that they're both turned into aesthetic objects to be consumed.
They didn't lay him out as the person he was. They
Up a level. Yeah,
they
prettied him up, right? He certainly doesn't look like he's just had a bad accident with a horse, right? There lay a young man, fast asleep, sleeping so soundly, so deeply, that he was far, far away from them both. Oh, so remote, so peaceful. He was dreaming. Never wake him up again. His head was sunk in the pillow. His eyes were closed. They were blind under the closed eyelids. He was given up to his dream. What did garden parties and baskets and lace frocks matter to him? He was far from all those things. He was wonderful, beautiful. While they were laughing and while the band was playing, this marvel had come to the lane. Happy, happy. All is well, said that sleeping face. This is just as it should be. I am content. So, by turning the corpse into an aesthetic object, how does Laura then manage to control her response to it? Before she looks at it and treats it as an object. How does she feel about being taken to it? Does she want to see the body? Yeah, she just wants to get the hell out of there as fast as she can, right? I'm gonna leave my little basket of goodies. Enjoy, right? Enjoy the egg and olive sandwiches. Yeah, I agree, that sounds disgusting. Enjoy the cream puffs. Yep, I'm out of here. But once she's shown the corpse and she turns him into a picture, he's not scary anymore, right? He's not threatening.
Does she use it through her own, the preset class view that she already has?
Yeah.
There's a prompt that she can actually attend to that.
Yeah, and this is the thing we've seen her doing through the whole story, right? The paterization of everything she runs across, right? She paterizes the workmen, particularly the tall, lanky one with the blue eyes, right? Who seems to, let's say, engage her interest a little bit. She aestheticizes him when he sniffs the lavender. She revels in the experience of the cream puff before lunch, right? Ooh, we're breaking the rules. We're eating a cream puff before lunch. And yeah, she's doing exactly the same thing to this corpse. Now, I would argue that this is, in fact, a learned response that is something that is not specific to her within her family. Right, because she's aestheticized the workmen to neutralize a threat, right? She's made class difference and death picturesque so that it's not scary. When was Laura told she looked a picture?
When she took on the
Yep. Yep. Except her mother was neutralizing the threat presented by Laura, right? By giving her the hat and turning her into a picture. Here, you look a picture in that, right? Now you're going to stop making noise about canceling the party and disrupting all our fun. So yeah, this process of aestheticizing is used to neutralize potential threats. And it's used by all of the Sheridans to control their world and keep it pretty, keep it innocent. When you turn everything into art, nothing is dangerous, right? A picture can't hurt you. A picture exists really only to give you pleasure, right? And the language of consumption and pleasure is all over this particular story. Right? The rose is at the beginning. The weather for the party, right? Page 286. And the weather was ideal. They could not have had a more perfect day for a garden party if they had ordered it. Windless, warm, the sky without a cloud. Only the blue was veiled with a haze of light gold, as it sometimes is in early summer. The gardener had been up since dawn, mowing the lawns and sweeping them, until the grass and the dark flat rosettes where the daisy plants had been seemed to shine. As for the roses, you could not help feeling they understood that roses are the only flowers that impress people at garden parties, the only flowers that everybody is certain of knowing. Right, there's the consumption of the canna lilies, right? The mother says, I shall finally have enough canna lilies, right? She's ordered every damn canna lily in town for their party. The father, when he's presented with the sandwiches, shoves one into his mouth, basically swallows it whole, and then has another. Everything in their world exists for their own pleasure and their own consumption. In fact, I think it's interesting here too, along these lines, the trees that the marquee is going to obscure when they put it up are karaka trees. Does anybody know anything about karaka trees, know what they are? The Karaka is the only plant mentioned in the story that is actually native to New Zealand. It bears a yellow fruit that has an edible pulp, but the seeds are toxic unless you roast them. So this native plant with poisonous seeds is the only thing in the garden that's blocked off. Right? They're not going to eat the fruit of the tree of knowledge, right? They want as little to do with their New Zealand context as possible. What they want is to replicate a kind of little British upper class garden party. Now, one thing that's going on here as well is the sort of dependence, like a kind of interdependence between metropolitan center and colony here. Mansfield was born in 1898. She died in 1923. She was only 25 years old when she died. Tuberculosis. And so when she was a child, there was a huge influx of people and goods from England into New Zealand. So a mass influx of settlers and of imports. New Zealand was one of those colonies that didn't send more back to England than it received from England, right? The usual colonial model was they went to a place to extract some resource from it, or resources. In New Zealand, that didn't really happen. New Zealand is tiny, right? It's pretty, it's Middle Earth, which is exactly what the New Zealand airline will tell you as you land in Wellington, you know, the little video on the plane. Welcome to Middle Earth. It's like, yeah, not really. Are you all very short and hairy? I don't know. But yeah, but New Zealand was dependent on Britain for most goods. The one thing that New Zealand does have a lot of is sheep. Lots and lots of sheep. Pardon? Oh, in the at the bay, yeah. Yeah. Yes, there will be plenty of sheep to go around. But yeah, so the food, the culture, the people, everything is brought in from elsewhere. So the fact that we've got a garden here reflects the fact that the whole settler culture in New Zealand is planted. No native roots. They're all hothouse flowers like the lilies. And hothouse flowers, right, while they are often beautiful, wither and die very quickly. So this indicates a kind of precariousness as well. Right, the little idyll that the Sheridans have in their garden, however much they try to keep the outside out, is essentially doomed. those streets are still there and going to encroach. The natural environments, the karaka trees, however much they try to push it out, however much they try to block it off, it's still there, it's going to encroach. There are reminders all around them of the precariousness of their class position and the precariousness of the local environment. That they're growing things in it that it can't support. So Mansfield's attitude towards New Zealand was for much of, I say for much of her life, you know, it's kind of hard to divide Mansfield's life into juvenile and mature phases because she died so young. But yeah, she has a kind of jaundiced attitude towards New Zealand and towards her upbringing. We'll see more of that in sort of more directly autobiographical stories like At the Bay. But yeah, she tended to regard New Zealand as a place without culture. She was interested in the Maori culture, that is the native culture of New Zealand, and made some friends among the Maori and, you know, went camping and, you know, their territory, that sort of thing. The kind of reservation-like areas that the British set up to put the Maori into. But it's one of those that there can be sort of no real strong connection there, right? She spent most of her adult life in Europe. Educated in London, and then bouncing around mostly to sort of various spas in Europe trying to get treatments for tuberculosis. One more thing I want to note about this story, and then we're kind of running low on time. We noted the influence of Walter Pater. Mansfield also read a lot of Oscar Wilde. Now, does anybody recall what the profession of the young workman who died was?
What is a carter?
He's a carter, yeah. And a carter is, you know, like a teamster, someone who drives a cart. Now, we didn't actually talk too much about this portion of the picture of Dorian Gray, in part because I think in this particular instance, I was trying to get you to like that chapter that you didn't, or at least to care about that chapter none of you liked. But there's a carter that appears in the picture of Dorian Gray. Shortly after, actually immediately after, Dorian has just left Sybil Vane for the last time, right? Having cruelly separated himself from her and shattered her bright young dreams and so on and so forth. So he's walking the streets in a daze, and a carter walks up and offers him a plate of cherries, free of charge. And this sort of completes Dorian's initiation into the decadence that will mark the latter half of his life. And there are some critics who argue that the fact that the young man who completes Laura's initiation into her family circle by becoming an aesthetic object is a carter, that's actually a nod to that particular scene in the picture of Dorian Gray. Which I'm willing to buy, it makes a fair amount of sense to me. Okay, so does anybody have any questions about anything, about any of what we've gone over today?
What was it you said she read a lot about?
She read a lot of Oscar Wilde.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. The picture of Dorian Gray is actually a big influence on her fiction. Other questions?
Are we going to discuss the daughters on Wednesday?
Yeah, we can go back to the daughters of the late Colonel on Wednesday and try to discuss that alongside Ethelbeth. I think Deontay has the presentation on Wednesday. And I think there are actually some pretty similar issues, particularly as regards time, in those two stories. So they'll actually probably match up pretty well together. So yeah, so we'll at least briefly refer to the daughters of the late Colonel next time. Yeah, Mary Catherine.
So what stories do I need to read for next time? Is it the...
At the Bay.
At the Bay.
Yep, At the Bay for next time.
And that's it?
Yeah, and the daughters of the late Colonel if you haven't already. Anything else? All right, and I'll give you the guide questions for At the Bay. And I will see you on Wednesday. Bless you.
Thank you.